easy for the three employees to attend. So again, welcome as well to Professor Brongersma. I'm really very interested to learn about LEIS, low emission ion scattering spectroscopy, or so I'll hand over to Hoshi to make the official tri-state announcement.
There was no official announcement. I'm glad to just continue to welcome everybody, and thank you very much for having us. Rice is extremely lucky to have somebody like Jürgen, our past president, to be so generous to have the meeting here and also to offer us the dinner afterwards. So my first thanks to you, Jürgen, and to Sushi for that. Rice is very delighted to have Dr. Brongersma here. I think this was arranged through Dr. Budden-William. And it's a very nice, I think, continuation of the last presentation that we had from Vadim about a month ago. So we're all very excited to learn more about light.
By the way, where is Vadim?
Something on the way. Oh, he was getting some water from me, I guess.
Oh.
But he must. Otherwise, I guess he knows about the introduction. Should I use him? No, you're slacking up. Well, first of all, of course, two thanks to, first of all, Mojito for inviting me. It's a great honor. Via Julian's, I had heard about this tri-state seminar for a number of years. We have a long-standing collaboration together, and so it's kind of fun to show the way we are doing things on Catalyst for this kind of audience. Thank you. And of course, to thank you very much for Zuidkemi for being able to be here. So, low energy ion scattering. What is, it's a new tool. What you should realize, perhaps if this seminar had been somewhere in Japan or China, and one would come into the audience, then always, very often, the students have prepared very well. They have read the literature, looked at all the textbooks, and so they know more or less what's going to happen. My hope is, I would say, the best way you could prepare for this seminar is by not having read any of the literature, because this is a very fast development, and in fact, if you would read the textbooks, then you would be biased, and it would take me more time to get you converted to what's really going on. So, let's see, this one. Oh, that's this one, okay. Great. So what I'll do is first I'll explain what is special about this high sensitivity, low energy ion scattering. And I'll say a few words, because otherwise you think, where does this guy come from? I'll say a few words about what Calypso is. And then I'll come to, at some length, about the features, because if low energy ion scattering is very different, you could not have read it, so I have to explain with some fundamentals how that goes about. But the major part of my talk will be to say examples, for instance, of real industrial catalysts, well, then probably we may have some intermission or whatever, and then I'll come to a couple of things we have done together with Fadi Julian's, very preliminary results, and some miscellaneous things that, which are just kind of fun to realize that it's not only catalysis, that the application is much wider, and are all kinds of applications you may not have thought of. So at the moment, you are dealing with either catalysis or many other fields, nanophysics nowadays, you like to get control at the atomic level. And once you do that, you like to also have a tool that can analyze that at the atomic level, and not only say you get some vague feeling, but quantitatively know what you're doing. We believe that low energy ion scattering in a modern way is giving you that kind of information. So just get back to the fundamentals for a second. Okay. Oh, I'm not sure what else. Can you see that in the back?
Mm-hmm.
Or yep. Otherwise I'll just... If you make noble gas ions like these, and you scatter them from a surface, so you start with energies of a few kiloelectron volt, you bounce them off from the surface, and it is just a billion ball game. So if you know the laws of conservation of momentum and energy, that's all you need to know to determine if a certain mass scatters from a certain atom, what kind of energy is after it. So the assignment of the peaks I'll show you later is straightforward. You get out is the atomic composition of the outermost atomic layer. So I'm very often stressing, and that doesn't mean that the other techniques are bad, but if you do surface analysis, generally you average over many, many layers. Now you are looking at one layer selectively. Of course, very often the combination of these two tools may bring you, because they are very complementary information, may bring you much further. And so in contrast to all the textbooks where they say, this problem is quantification, whatever, if you know how to do it, this is a quantitative technique, a copper in a copper environment has the same sensitivity as a copper on a highly dispersed catalyst in whatever environment. So you can simply calibrate, there are no matrix effects, and of course there are some exceptions, but we know how to deal with that. You're stronger than I am, that's it. Okay, I should more hit it. Okay, there. you've been practicing this for years, I can see that. Okay, sorry. Yeah, there's still a lot of things I have to learn. So if you do ion scattering from a surface, and in this case you take neon ions of about 3 kiloelectron volt, you bounce them off from the surface, then you get a mass spectrum. So if you scatter from something heavy like iridium, you keep, you're left with 2 kiloelectron volt, and when you are low, the lower the mass, the peaks are somewhere to the left. Okay, yes. So what is special about what we do in Eindhoven? Well, we invested about 450 person years in the development of a new tool, and that's what you see here, which means say about 150 person years of my permanent staff at the university, and say over 200 persons getting a master's and maybe 40 getting a PhD on the machine and related fields. And what is special about it is that first, well, you have to make ions, so you have an ion source. You select them so you know, I am working with helium-4, for instance. They go through all the way, they scatter from the surface, and they get into an electrostatic field. And the trick is that because of that electrostatic field, the fast ions move to the outside, finally end up next to the axis, and so you make an image in energy. And because you make an image in energy, you don't have to scan through the spectrum, which requires time, and time means sensitivity, And time also means if I bombard with ions, I would destroy my surface. So because of this image and a couple of other tricks, we have increased the sensitivity of this technique to, say, a factor of 3,000 higher than the best other ion scattering machine in the world. And a factor of 3,000 means, if you work at a university, well, your student has really got to do over hours if he wants to make up for the factor of 3,000. And so suddenly you start seeing things you could never see before. Of course, you can also change the polarity, and then if you have an X-ray source like some of our machines have, you can look for the secondary electrons and do X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy in the same machine at the same time. Okay, so this is because our dose is so extremely low. This is called static low energy ion scattering, and because of the parallel detection we get a little thing. Now, if you had looked at the interior of that analyzer, you would have seen this kind of shape. So maybe if we go 1 second back, if that would work. My Maybam, now I'm asking too much. Well, if you would, otherwise let me just continue. If you would have looked at the shape you saw a minute ago from the interior, that is this, which means that this is a rotational symmetric thing, and the contours are kind of special. We took, say, one full year on the biggest computer to calculate them and make a nice image. Yes, we just continue, that's okay. What is the effect? Well, here you have a real catalyst. So we talk about palladium platinum nanoclusters on top of a carbon support, 1,000 square meters per gram. So an extremely highly dispersed thing. And so that means that if you would take a regular surface science tool, you would see only carbon. You wouldn't see anything else. In the old days, we were already excited. We can see the palladium and the platinum. But we had to use a dose of 10,000 nanocoulomb, which is in practice a lot of ions. Now, the difference with the old machines, like they are everywhere else in the world, and the new one is that we have now reduced our dose from 10,000 to 5 nanocoulomb, and you will see that the statistics is significantly better. That is the advantage of having that special analyzer. That's why we worked for so many years to just get that machine going. Now, to be a little bit fair with you, I fudged that picture a little bit. Because, you see the background here and the background there is very nice and flat. I have been drawing that myself. Why? Because if you have a real catalyst, it's not only this very low loading of palladium platinum alloy nanoparticles, there are of course promoters and other things on the surface which are very important on industrial catalysts. I've removed them for you. So that does not mean we cannot see them. Yes, in a normal life we can quantify promoters that are at the surface. So this is already quite a few years ago, 1992, that we got that result, and so then we had a big concerted effort to really develop to a stage that it is a commercial and a nice machine you can use by just pressing the buttons. Yes, next one. So, summarizing, we look at the outermost atomic layer, and of course the outermost atomic layer is not only important for catalysis, but for a lot of other things like growth, adhesion, what have you. Now, although most of you are probably aware, I still want to spend 1 minute to make you realize how important, how different the outermost atomic layer is from what's deeper down, and I'll show you examples of that later. Imagine you have a pure single crystal, ideal. You cleave it, you prepare two surfaces, And so the atoms that were first in the interior, in nice equilibrium with its neighbors, suddenly they are exposed at the outside surface, which means they have been broken bonds and had an asymmetric environment. Of course, they started rearranging a little bit, they don't like this, but at the same time, the composition of this outer layer is going to change because some atoms like to be at the surface, have a low surface energy, some ones definitely want to be away. So that is why the surface in general, and you can look at catalysts, you can look at polymers, or you can look at whatever, but in practice, even if you have done techniques like XPS, TOF SIMS, or whatever, this outer surface in real life is very different from what you think it is. And these problems relate to, say, 85%, both whether you are in chemistry or in electronic industry, about 85% of the problems relate somewhere to surfaces or interfaces. I'm not the first one to realize the importance of the surface. If you are a Dutchman, then you would know Escher, and in fact, lots of Americans know Escher, the graphic artist who made many pictures. And this is one where he shows you, on the one hand, the fish in the water, the solid, the liquid. He shows you the trees in the reflection, the outside. But he also has the leaves, just emphasizing there is an interface, and that interface is very different from what real life is, and that's what we see in many, many cases. This is a very old picture. In fact, we got a little bit famous in the early 70s by showing that if you have a copper-nickel alloy and you heat that a little bit, and those days we had to heat a little higher than we have to do now, but you heat to 500 degrees C in this case, and in your mass spectrum, you will see that in the beginning, at room temperature, you have nickel, and nickel has isotopes, so you have this extra bump is related to nickel. You have copper, which has two isotopes, so you have about 50-50 of those, but at the moment you heat it, you anneal it, the copper will segregate out and form a monolayer on top of that surface. Next one. Just zeroth order theory, which is as crude as you can think, but just for your thing. If you have an atom in the bulk, and in my case it has always six bonds in the bulk, if you would evaporate it, you break all the bonds. If you go to the surface, you break, say, two out of six, one third of it. So going to the surface will cost you about one third of the evaporation energy, very, very crudely speaking. Copper has low boiling point compared to nickel, so copper comes out of the surface. What's important about this picture is that you will realize that an atom that is not in the top layer, but one layer below, it has already the environment. You are not breaking any bonds. Maybe you change your neighbor from copper to nickel, but that's the second order effect. So because of that, it means that the segregation is always confined, not 100%, but close to that, to 100%, to the top atomic layer. That is why that top atomic layer is very different from the deeper ones. So if you want to understand, you don't want to assume, I analyze an average of 20 layers, and then I know more or less what's going on. No, that top layer, you really have, if you're interested in the top layer, you have to analyze the top layer. Just a few more things to rub it in. If you have a substrate, and that could also be roughing, it's easier to draw it flat. If you have a substrate with these orange atoms, in ion scattering you will only see the orange atoms. If you have a substrate with pinholes, you will see not the blue ones, you will see the orange and the dark blue background, the support. And if you have clusters, you will only see these six atoms on top and not the rest. So and I'll show you later examples where we do that, by knowing how much in total is on your catalyst by bulk analysis and combining that design, scattering, you say, ah, I see this much, there must be that, my average radius of the cluster is so much. And that's how it works. And of course, when you do other techniques, and like here also, when you absorb molecules on a substrate, ion scattering sees these top layer, say the green ones, the backbone, or the orange ones. And when you combine that with other techniques like SIMS, tough SIMS, or XPS, you will probe a different depth. And so it's very complementary information to what we are doing here. Last one. Ion scattering, depending on where you are in the periodic system, your sensitivity goes, say, from somewhere around 1% to 1 part per, or 10 part per million, 10 minus 5, of a monolayer. So that's not so many atoms. Compared to SIMS, probes significantly deeper, and, well, apart from quantification problems, for some elements it's extremely sensitive, but generally we are a good match. And XPS, OG are of course much less sensitive. You may worry about roughness. And again, I would say, don't read the textbooks, because in the textbooks you'll see, if you have a supported catalyst, you are going to lose a factor of 100 or so of your sensitivity. Here you see we made specifically silica supports, and they range from 50 to 380 square meters per gram. And we plot these signals for silicon and oxygen as a function of roughness. There's no influence. Well, if you go to really extremely flat ones, like a flat piece of quartz, then you have a little bit more, you have 23% more of signal than you have now. And we can correct it, and we understand why it's 23%. So it is not magic, it's just the geometry of the whole thing. So the fun is that you can just as well look at real catalyst as at model systems which have something flat. So, summarizing, outermost layer connected to chemistry. You can change your mass resolution. You will use helium for carbon and polymers. But for instance, if you have a, well, let's say, silver palladium kind of alloy, which is close, the masses overlap, then you have to use the argon, and then you can separate the silver and the palladium, to give an example. Quantification is simple. You get the analysis before damage. You can do isolating samples, rough surfaces, any temperature. We have been up to 2,300 degrees centigrade. Well, that is white hot, even for tungsten. And yeah, this is not in situ. You have the problem of the pressure gap. You have to work in a certain amount of vacuum that the ions can get through, which means essentially we generally work at 10 minus 6 bar or better, although some of my machines have a special pressure stage and we go to 10 minus 2. Thank you.
Cool.
1 minute commercial about Calypso. What does it do? Well, we have of permanent staff 150 person years. It's much more sensitive. Unique sensitivity for the outer layer. And there are, say, apart from catalysis, lots of applications in ceramics, membranes, macromolecules, and a lot of other fields. Thank you. What does Calypso do? It provides analytical services, so people fly in with their samples from all over the world, and we help them solve problems. And in addition, since very recently, since last year, we started marketing the machine that does that, which has all kind of special options, etc. We can always come back later if necessary. Thank you. This is, looks like, okay, now let's get to science. Start with a highly dispersed silica. So the rest of my examples are never flat. They are really supported systems. This is, you have added some molybdenum oxide to the silica, and you heat it, and as a function of temperature, you will see that the silicon signal goes down and the molybdenum signal goes up. The statistics is not so good because that was still my old machine. So yes, what is happening? You had clusters of molybdenum oxide and they spread, they wet the surface, and at the end they wet 100%. And if you want to know the sensitivity, well, this is about 4 times more than here. So we need know from other means that this is a monolayer, so this was 4 atomic layer thick of molybdenum oxide. Spinels, the things like zinc aluminate and others, cations in 2 different kinds of environments. And when you look at it, it's again an old slide with the worst statistics, you will see for the zinc aluminum aluminate, you will see an aluminum peak and an oxygen peak. And you will see a background, but no zinc. Why? Because the zinc is in the second atomic layer. The zinc is in the tetrahedral site, and ion scattering only sees, well, for normal spinel, it's only the octahedral sites that are exposed to the power. So, yes, if you say, you are not sensitive to zinc, well, we check the zinc oxide, you get a nice zinc peak, and you know you have sensitivity. It is just, and if I go to the next one, because zinc is not, aluminate is not a major catalyst, but if you, we looked at maybe about 30 or 40 different spinels, different compositions and playing different tricks. And so this is with manganese, and you will see, for instance, which is kind of fun, when you plot, we use the test reaction together with the group of Professor Ponich at Leiden University. We used a test reaction to see what the activity of the catalyst was. And we plotted that activity against the number of manganese atoms in the top layer. And you will see, for instance, you get 2 dots here. The 2 dots means that is either the aluminum, the zinc manganese oxide or the Mn3O4. Why do they give the same yield and the same number of ions? Because when you have a spinel, the 2 that are in the octahedral site, they are on top. And the 3rd one is in the tetrahedral site. You cannot see it with ion scattering, and it does not contribute anything to chemical activity. So that is the fun. So we have many examples where it's always a direct one-to-one relationship between the kind of active cations you see and what your how effective your reaction is. So for spinels, octahedral sites, which is the B1 in the normal spinel, and there's a direct relationship. And if it's in tetrahedral site, it has no activity and we don't see it. And for a lot of other oxides, we have found maybe not as strict rules what is at the surface, but in general, a mixed oxide will never be at the surface what you put in the bulk. There's a complete different stoichiometry, and that is determined. Say a little bit about oxygen membranes, solid oxide fuel cells and things. For these cases where you have in fact very little surface area, it is the surface really that determines how well it works. And people know for various reasons that very often the performance of that membrane or fuel cell is very much hampered by the surface, and they don't know why. So why is it different? What is at the surface? And so we have studied a number of these, and this is one of them. This is membranes which should be very transparent, say for oxygen selection. It should have things like, well, as the name is, lanthanum, strontium, cobalt, iron in it. Now, if you really look at that membrane, and then you should look at the top layer, which is the black one. Well, you move at that time 1/10 of a monolayer. You will see there is no cobalt and there is no iron. There's only a background there. The top of that membrane consists of strontium, lanthanum, and some dirt. Say, that's only alkali, earth alkali, silicon, things like that. Now, only when you remove a certain number of layers, you get this cobalt out. Of course, if you know anything about, say, Mars van Grevelen kind of reactions, where the oxygen molecules should come, adsorb, dissociate, and be adsorbed by the lattice, you need multivalent cations. Then you can adsorb an oxygen ion. If you come in with things like strontium, strontium is two valent and it's very difficult to change, make that change valency. So this one is just poisoned by the fact that the surface energy of the strontium and the lanthanum, its oxides, are so much lower than that of the cobalt and the iron, and so the black one doesn't show it, and that's why there's a significant barrier for oxygen diffusion. Same too for if you go to yttrium stabilized, very famous for oxygen fuel cells. Again, the oxygen should get in the lattice and be transported. When you look at the surface, at the temperature where you operate it, you will not see a single atom of yttria or zirconia. It should be there, but you have enrichment of things like, when you look here again, we have two different samples, but look at the red one, you will see only calcium and some background because of yttrium zirconia. Yes, they are there in the second and the third and deeper atomic layers, but they are not in the top layer. And if we go to the next one, we have looked at things like isotopic exchange, 016, 018. That should tell you whether there is really a barrier or not. Well, you see, when we heat these samples to such a temperature, you get more and more and more calcium on it. Here we plot the fraction of isotopic exchange. By the time we get to a full monolayer of calcium, the isotopic exchange has been reduced to zero. So you have a complete barrier. One atomic layer controlling and just killing you for this application. And then you say, I should buy just a little bit better yttrium zirconia. Well, this is the best, the highest quality you could ever get. And when you do the thermodynamics and the calculation, you should be a factor of 300 more pure than what is the best available in the world. So this is not something you are going to solve in a free Saturday afternoon. You really have to think, how do I get reduce calcium by, say, three orders of magnitude. Now I want to get to a few realistic catalysts. Of course, we have done all kind of other catalysts, but I'll take just a few examples which are characteristic to show something. These are what I call knots, no other technique available. So that means you get certain information that is different from what you could get with the techniques I know. So the three-way catalyst has these platinum-rhodium clusters. It has a support of gamma alumina plus some cerium oxide. And it's known that after a cold start, the efficiency of that catalyst drops. And by all kind of kinetic modeling and doing things with ethylene, the chemist, I'm half chemist, I still talk about the chemist. So the people doing this reaction, they said, well, it looks like about 40% of the platinum is covered, perhaps with coke. That could be one explanation. So we checked that. And so we looked and we saw a loss of the platinum signal after a cold start of 50% of platinum. Say, great. Well, there could be two explanations. It could be that the carbon is on top, coke, or that there is some sintering and your surface area has been reduced. So what we did is we did some oxidation at room temperature, so no treatment, this atomic oxygen, you take away all the carbon as CO2, you remove it, and you get your platinum rhodium signal 100% back again. So yes, it was poisoned by coke. Now, what is special about iron scattering here? Not that we can see the carbon. Any surface technique will always show you the carbon. So what? What you're interested in, what about my clusters? What about my active phase, the platinum and the rhodium? Are they covered by carbon, yes or no? So the fun is that we can selectively determine which fraction of the active phase is covered by carbon. And just the way I do it here for carbon, we have done very similar things with slightly different kind of tricks and treatments, that we, if there is a promoter, and you like to know, well, is the promoter somewhere just anywhere on the support, or is the promoter, say, on top of my, all of my active phase? That's an important issue, you want to know that. And we have ways of verifying where it is sitting. Not only quantify how much is there, but also quantify which fraction is sitting on a thermal phase. Backing up more, Marks?
I figured out it.
You're growing. just a little at the end, we use this nowadays for quality control of catalysts. So if you have an exhaust catalyst and you buy this catalyst from a supplier, you don't want to know that, so many grams of platinum per support. You want to know how much is available for catalysis. And so by quantifying what is the available surface area of platinum, that helps enormously. And especially here, the fact that you have cerium oxide, the heavy element around, a lot of the other techniques don't work so well, and so we get away with it. So we help here with quality control for those colors. Yes, thank you. So this is still, particularly this three-way catalyst, you have these clusters, and you'd like to know how big are they. So if you know from a bulk analysis how much there is in total, which is, say, the metal weight fraction, forget a moment about the geometric factor, then here there are just, we measure how much you can see. We measure this part, the top layer. If you know the average size and you know the surface, you divide and essentially you get a ratio of those clusters. So we determine, in this case, we determine for this kind of load, we determine that the average cluster is 1.6 nanometer. That is plus or minus a tenth of a nanometer. Of course, if you have a very narrow distribution, we have checked that, and yes, we get within a tenth of a nanometer. On the other hand, if you very often when you do TEM or other things, you look at the bigger clusters and they say, it's 3 nanometers, and we say, no, it's 1.1, which means there's a distributed phase as well in addition. So the combination of the techniques there is very important. This works well up to clusters of about 10 nanometers, then we lose the accuracy and it's not so good. Methanol synthesis, copper zinc. I'm just trying to select some, say, call it universal catalyst to show that these systems where everyone has worked on it, you can still contribute something new and have some fun with it. So this is the copper zinc oxide catalyst. And generally, and people like Charlie Campbell has used it already many years ago to look at these things, but he could not separate the copper and zinc because they are next to each other in the periodic system, also doing iron scattering. So we have checked it out a little bit. We took the 63 copper and 68 zinc isotopes, then they are far away and it's easy. Nowadays our machine is so much better that I know we can separate copper zinc also without isotopically enriched samples. If you go to the next one, what you plot here is the ratio of zinc to copper, what we see. And here at zero, that is the real surface. We can, of course, sputter, bombard, and erode a little bit, and with all the problems that you have on by doing it and find the depth profile. But at the surface, we get the real numbers. The purple line is the bulk composition. So you will see that you get this enormous enrichment of zinc oxide at the surface. So in fact, you have clusters. So this is a real catalyst on a silica support, copper zinc oxide, and these copper particles have a coating of zinc. And the coating, the enrichment depends on, if you listen to guys like Henrik Topsø and the people of the Topsø company, this we have used, for instance, this one, this is their mixture, how you should do methanol synthesis, by the right, having the right amounts of CO, CO2, and hydrogen, and you see that you get a fantastic more than order of magnitude enrichment at the surface. Next one. Well, you have many, many surface techniques, and of course, XPS has the great advantage that it gives you not only what's there, but it gives you oxidation states, valences. That's nice. We don't do that. We get, in principle, only the composition of the outer atomic layer. You can do chemical titration. You can see how it goes and whatever, but everyone who has ever done chemical titration knows that this is a tricky business. It's not easy. And you never know whether that's only at the top or in the second atomic layer a little bit, etc. Lots of difficulties. Well, the shielding, if a copper is in an oxidative environment, there is some oxygen shielding, and that has an influence of the signal. So what we have used is ion scattering plus chemical titration with N2O to put the oxygen on. And in that way, we can get the, both, not only the composition, but the valency of the copper and the zinc in the top layer. And if I go to the next one, then you will see that at low temperatures where you do the reduction, you will get, say, clusters which have, say, mainly a lot of zinc oxide, some copper 1+, and no neutral species in the top layer. And when you go to higher temperatures, we see it sintered, the clusters get bigger, and you see the composition is very different. Although in the bulk, it's still a factor of copper to zinc is a factor of 9. So yes, and so the fun is that you don't only see the valencies, but you see the valencies of the top layer, while XPS averages over, say, 10 or 20 atomic layers. So it's for catalytic purposes, it's kind of nice. I hope I don't offend anyone with it, but it's kind of nice, and there are all kinds of places where this is not so easy and XPS is much better, but it's kind of nice that for oxides, you can determine the valency in the outermost atomic layer. Now, I don't know how long I've been talking. I should look at. Should I look at you or? Okay, then I'll say a little bit about what we've been doing with as first with the group in Cincinnati of Adi Julians. Then I'll have a sip of water and then we'll discuss some other topics, miscellaneous things. Julians, he has been working on special oxides, well, both simple ones and complicated ones, as you see here. And our interest was at Calypso, can you combine, just like you do the, say, well, I've showed you the 016, 018 exchange, I've shown you how carbon sits and we know what's there and what's not there. It would be fun if you could use all the knowledge you have in chemisorption together with ion scattering. Because if something absorbs, I don't see any more what's below. So I can, if I, this chemical titration, if I absorb something, yes, I could try infrared spectroscopy and techniques like that, and that may work, but sometimes that's not so one-to-one simple interpretation. So in cases where you doubt it or you want a real exact quantitative number, it is kind of fun to combine low energy ion scattering with chemisorption. And so what you do is you take the pure catalyst, take the spectrum, absorb something on top, take the difference, and the difference will tell you where the molecule was sitting. That does not immediately mean, of course, that this was the active site. You can fight about it, but at least it was the site where it was being absorbed. And so we have been using low energy ion scattering to try to understand a little bit more about this selective oxidation of propane to acrylic acid that is heavily studied at Cincinnati. And we would like to do is say you like to do many things, but one of the things you like to do is say put a molecule on top, let it say heat, let it dissolve again and see what happens. And so we use two type of probe molecules, methanol and allyl alcohol, and the story goes that the methanol is supposed to sit on, say, any vanadium, on the single vanadium sites, but the allyl alcohol requires two sites. So the fun would be if you could not only know about the atoms in the surface, but know about their environment. And so can you, by combining molecules and low energy ion scattering, learn about the environment of surface atoms? Next one. So this was, well, understood he gave a seminar here 2 months ago, so you know much more than I know about it. But so the idea is to go from propane via propene via the alcohol, well, and then hopefully not, all the way to the acrylic acid, and hopefully not to the CO2 and other things. And the idea is that there may well be different sites for the first part of the reaction and the other one. So we are not by far in understanding all of that yet. I mean, this is just the very, very beginning, but if I may have the next one. For instance, to start off with that complicated mixed oxide, we looked at the surface fraction of what you would expect on the basis of the bulk and what you would expect an oxidized should have said surface, what you would have expected on the basis of what we see at the surface. And so you will see, yes, there is in the vanadium, there's more in the bulk than at the surface. There's less molybdenum. The niobium in this case is almost the same. And at the surface, you have a lot more tellurium. So the surface composition definitely is not what you just get by looking at the bulk composition. Now, then you try, and in fact, that meant more that in Cincinnati, they synthesized, say, what they call good catalyst and bad catalyst. Bad catalyst is easy to synthesize. That is just a very simple one. The good catalyst should have a significantly better selectivity and activity towards acrylic acid. And so we have looked at both, and we have seen that the covered surface, so first we absorb at, not at room temperature, because then it will be fully covered. You do it at, say, 110 degrees, 130 degrees, you absorb these molecules, and you see how much goes there on top of the surface. Let's go to the next one. The absorption, at this case, first of all, you see that there is a preferential absorption on the vanadium. That means if you look at the atomic composition, you see that the vanadium signal is suppressed especially. And There is also a much stronger, and that a much means a factor of 3 or more adsorption on the bad catalyst. So one way of explaining it would say, well, apparently these promoters, these modifiers, apparently help to make sure that you do not completely poison the surface, because it's not only at the beginning, also after desorption, the bad catalyst stays poisoned much longer than the good one. When you do what we call one turnover, then whatever, which means I've absorbed it, I've desorbed it, and afterward I've oxidized the surface again. Once we do that, so we get back in principle to the original situation, we see that there are major changes in the surface composition. So that means, for instance, the tellurium is very strongly, by quite a significant factor, not a few percent, but by a factor, it's being reduced, and it has an effect on the increase of the molybdenum and niobium. So when you think about multiple sites and possibilities, one of the possibilities may be that the what the tellurium is doing is helping to promote that you get multiple sites after such a process. But there are many, this is still many other things. So that concludes a little bit. Most of the things I would like to say about catalysts I had still, so either we stop a few minutes or we just, I mean, that's up to you how you feel. I don't know what you're, or I finish up by showing you a little bit what I would call miscellaneous and give you a few more thoughts of how ion scattering works.
Well, we can see if there are any questions right now.
That at least I get a little bit of water. That would be great. Oh yeah.
Well, there's some questions.
Yeah. Well, let's first see what it is.
Let's start with. Okay. I have a question. Maybe we can elaborate a little bit on the example you gave on the copper zinc system. And on the great work, topsy did, and by the way, it's sort of circulated with no problem, and topsy here.
Well, yeah. This is still at the level of science, right? What I presented.
Analyzing or characterizing copper zinc catalysts or methanocyanate catalysts or catalyst precursors always is a problem when you want to characterize copper, zinc, and the hydrotalkite-like precursor.
Yeah.
Would that be a technique to separate or to analyze and to quantify copper and zinc in that hydrotalkite precursor phase?
I think so. I think you should be able to do that, yes.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the essence of all. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so we will have later an opportunity.
Just to add a little bit on the copper zinc oxide. In fact, at some stage there were not everyone in the world, but lots of people. I mean, this is an important catalyst. So lots of people have worked on it, and everyone has his own model, and then say, this and that. So you have to work first of all together with people who know about this. Otherwise, so you have to collaborate. And this was for a PhD, so I can. This is free literature, and I can freely talk about it, what we found and what we did. In fact, one of the models of the German scientist was that these were clusters where, if you have a copper cluster, the zinc oxide was between the copper cluster and the support, and the surface would be copper. And there might be some copper ions, 1+ always in it. Well, first of all, being a semi-physicist, semi-chemist, it goes against my reasoning, because copper has a very high surface energy and zinc oxide has a very low one. So in fact, but since they had the technique, they could see surfaces or interfaces where they could not make the difference, they had to turn their cluster upside down, and then suddenly everything fit. So when I gave a talk some time ago at the topside place, then they said, oops, that's against our model. And then Henrik came out and said, well, yes, I have also thought about it. And so he also had the upside down model in his drawer. So yes, you get a different kind of information. And I think there was no question about it that you have zinc oxide more or less covering with a couple of copper 1 plus cations in the top layer.
I have a question. What is the spot size of the ion beam?
Very much depending on your application. The minimum spot size I can do is about 10 to 20 microns. So for microelectronics, that's still big, but it's that would work very well for metals, alloys, and things. Once you get to catalyst, 10, 20 microns is on the small size. The problem is, well, you need a minimum current to get enough information. Otherwise, you. So what you do is, you, if you have heavy elements where you have good signals, okay, then you can narrow down your beam and it's enough. But if you get to polymers where the signals are, say, one or two orders of magnitude lower, then we generally do say 100 microns or even 300 microns. And we have been up to analyzing super low fluence by going to 30 square centimeters, still a lot, of target. So you get only one ion here and one ion there to do your analysis, just for the fun of showing.
So have you tried to image a surface by scanning the ion beam?
We do sometimes scanning. What we do more often, and that has to do, of course, you are not as sensitive as, even with this new analyzer, you are not as sensitive as, say, an electron microscope and things like that. So we do line scans quite regularly. So, for instance, I could show you an example. Worked for a car factory. They had problems with the coating on the steel. So you have coatings. And we first make, by looking at with the ions on, we scan the ion beam very fast, look for the secondary electron pattern, and we say, ah, pinhole there, pinhole there. We put a line scan across those pinholes, then do the ion scattering. And so what you see is, you see the coating, then suddenly you get into that pinhole, and the fun is that you don't see the steel. If it had been just the steel or the oxidized steel, then there would be no reason why that coating would not cover everything. There is a reason why there are pinholes. And so the fun is that we focus on the bottom of that pinhole. Look, there's one atomic layer thick contamination which prevents the wetting by the coating. And so we analyzed that, and two days later the company was back in business again. And none of the XPS, TOF, SIMS and other techniques, they have tried all of them, none had any success in finding out, because you want selective and you want one atomic.
Since this is great to have this opportunity with your technique to have just that one atomic layer. But with the advances now, with the stem being able to use the aberration corrected and also using the monochromatic beam, I guess, is there a trend where you work to combine the ability to get very good imaging? I guess what you just brought up, when to get the very good imaging in combination with your analytical capability.
Yeah, it is a good point, the aberration. In principle, in this case, it's not so much the aberration. I used to work at Philips Electronics. So when I designed for them some machines, well, when you design electron microscopes, you know everything about aberration, so we have the best programs for designing lenses in the world. So it is not the aberration, but it is just that if I focus down, if I want to analyze this and I focus down my beam on this tiny spot, then I need so many ions to get enough signal. And by the time I get my analysis done, I have sputtered removed this because of sputtering damage. So it is just the sensitivity of the ion scattering technique by which it is no point. Well, my co-workers claim they have done 3 microns and still looked at the outermost atomic layer. But I mean, once I start looking at the second and the third and the tenth atomic layer, then you may say, ah, why do ion scattering? So it is more the damage that is increased, and you maybe if you come back to us next year, we have improved our machine a little bit, and we get a little tight, smaller spot.
This is a wonderful technique. I'm really pleased to learn about this. Very often we still encounter some difficulty with the catalysis work. Sometimes we run reaction at the temperature and now on a certain atmosphere. How do we take the advantage of this technique, knowing that if we were to change the catalyst from the operating condition to something that we can handle, put into the vacuum chamber, knowing that the surface may restructure, change the chemical states, and things like that. What would be your advice?
Yes, so